The for loop is a sequence iteration that assigns items in sequence to target one at a time and runs the block of code for each item. Unless the loop is terminated early with the break statement, the block of code is run as many times as there are items in the sequence. Let's look at the for loop using a simple diagram. Consider a sequence like this. We're going to add a few objects here. This is our sequence. I'm just going to call that SAQ. If we have a for loop where we say for target in sequence, the following thing happens. First, target is going to point to the object at location 0 in the sequence, and it's going to run the block of code that's connected with the for compound statement. During the next iteration, target will be pointing to this object here in position 1, and so on. Finally, at the very end of the loop, target will be pointing to the very last object in that sequence, and then run the block of code. Let's practice the use of for loops in Python. Let's first set up a sequence of 10 numbers, and we want to be using for to loop over this sequence. So I'm going to type for x in range of 10, and maybe I'll just want to print out the number. So I'll just simply type print x, and Python loops over the range sequence and prints out the numbers one at a time. Let's now try to apply this for a different type of sequence. I've previously defined a list called names, which consists of 6 different names. What I'd like to do is use a for loop to iterate over all of the names on this list. I'm going to say something like for name in names, and let's print out the name. So what Python is doing is it's going over my list of names and it's printing them out one at a time. If you're coming to Python from another language, you might be tempted to use an index to get out the different names from your list. So let's try to implement this code in a slightly different way. This certainly works. I can say something like for I in range length of names. So what I'm doing here is I'm asking Python to return the length of the names list. Then I'm constructing a range object. Then I'll type print names, and I use I to index a location on my list. And this works just the same way. What I've done here is I've created a range object that goes over all of the index locations of the list names. Now, this approach certainly works, but it's not a very Pythonic way to do this. What do I mean by that? Well, if we think about something like the English language, a natural language, you could certainly say Boston is a principal city, but that doesn't quite sound right. Most people would say Boston is a major city. In the same way, people more familiar with Python would prefer the first way of constructing the for loop, where we say for name in names, and then simply iterate over the list. I've previously constructed a dictionary, which is called age. In this dictionary, the keys are names of people and the values are the ages of these people. It's very common to use a for loop to iterate over all of the key value pairs in a dictionary. Remember, by typing age.keys, I get a dictionary view object, which gives me a dynamic view of all of the keys in my dictionary. Since dictionaries are accessed by their keys, it makes sense to use a loop variable that somehow conveys what the keys of the dictionary actually stand for. In this case, when setting up my for loop, I'm going to call the loop variable name, because the keys in my dictionary are names, and I'm just going to type for name in age.keys. What I can do next is I can print out the key, which is name, and the age of the person associated with that key. To do that, I type age, followed by square brackets, and I put in the key inside the square brackets. What happens here is the following. Python is first printing out the name of the person and then the value object, the age of the person, following the key. Because looping over a dictionary is such a common operation, there is actually a shorthand way of doing it. I can go back to my previous code where I typed for name in age.keys, and I can just simply remove the .keys part. Here I'm left with for name in age. If I run this code, the output is just the same. Remember that in a Python dictionary, a given key always goes with the associated object. However, remember that the key value pairs themselves don't follow any particular ordering inside the dictionary. In some applications, we would like to loop over the dictionary keys in some order, perhaps in an alphabetical order. I can accomplish that by doing the following. Let me go back to my old line for name in age. If I would like to sort the keys, I'd first extract the keys by saying age.keys, and then I use the built-in function sorted to create a new list in which the dictionary keys have been alphabetically sorted. When I run this code, I'll see that the keys appear in an alphabetical order. Occasionally, you may want to loop over your dictionary keys in reverse order. To accomplish this, we can still use the sorted function, but now we have to provide an additional attribute, reverse. So I take my previous line of code and I add reverse equals true. And when I run the code now, the keys will appear in reversed alphabetical order. In addition to the for loop, Python also has a while loop. The Python while is used for repeated execution of code as long as a given expression is true. The while loop repeatedly tests the expression. If the expression is true, it executes the first block of code. If the expression is false, it executes the second block of code, if present, and then terminates the loop. Sometimes there is some confusion about when to use a for loop and when to use a while loop. Here is one way to think about this. For a while loop, you're testing some condition some number of times. When you enter that loop, you don't know how many times exactly you will be running through that loop. This is in contrast with for loops, where when beginning the loop, you know exactly how many times you would like to run through the block of code.